Good job, kids. Hey, everybody, how we doing? Why don't we stand up together? Man, adults in the room, this is the kind of energy I'm looking for, okay? We have coffee, it's for free, there's donuts, there's plenty of caffeine and sugar. Let me read a passage of scripture. We have baptism coming up a little later in the service, and we have communion as well. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8 says this, "Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David. Such is my gospel, for which I suffer hardship to the point of imprisonment as a criminal. But God's message is not imprisoned. So I endure all things for the sake of those chosen by God, and they too may obtain salvation in Christ Jesus and its eternal glory. This saying is trustworthy. If we die with him, we also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. And if we're unfaithful, he remains faithful, since he cannot deny himself." Come on, let's worship, guys. I will never forget the moment I met you, moment you called my name. You pulled me out of the darkness, you made me a promise to never thirst again. All that I ever wanted, my heart has found in you. Let's sing this out. I have tasted life. Nothing satisfies like you do. The fount that won't run dry. Nothing satisfies like you do. That you offer your living water, drink from the endless well. And I will sit at your table, forever grateful, forever where you dwell. All that I ever wanted, my heart has found in you. I've tasted. I have tasted life. Nothing satisfies like you do. The fount that won't run dry. Nothing satisfies like you do. Let's declare this truth. All my fountains. All my fountains are in you. All my hope is built on your love. All my fountains are in you. With every breath I live. Your love, oh my
my heart has found in you.
I've tasted.
I have tasted life. Nothing satisfies like you do. The fount that won't run dry. Nothing satisfies like you do. It's when the storm's out on the ocean and the violent wind gets to blowing. Oh, take me back, back, all the way back. Oh, take me back to my first love.
One more time.
Oh, when the storm's out on the ocean and the violent wind gets to blowing. Oh, take me back,
take me back,
back, all the way back.
One more time.
Oh, take me back, back, all the way back. Oh, take me back to my first love.
Blessed are those who run to him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake them. Blessed are those who seek his face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your voice with me. He's worthy of all our praise. Blessed are those who walk with him, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage with Jesus. They'll see his glory. Blessed are those who die to live, whose joy it is to give it all for Jesus and for him only. Oh, Jesus, all for your glory. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your voice with me. He's worthy of all our praise. Come on and bring your offering. Sing if you've known his grace. Come on and lift up your holy hands. He's worthy of all our praise. Bless God in the sanctuary. Bless God in the fields of plenty. Bless God in the darkest valley. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when my hands are empty. Bless God with the praise that costs me. Bless God when nobody's watching. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when the weapon's forming. Bless God when the walls are falling. Bless God, cause he goes before me. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God, cause he holds the victory. Bless God, for he's always with me. Bless God, for he's always worthy. Every chance I get, I bless your name.
Every chance I get, I bless your name. Every chance I get, come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your voice with me. He's worthy of all our praise. Come on and bring your offering. Sing if you've known his grace. And come on and lift up your holy hands. He's worthy of all our praise. Yes, he's worthy of all our praise.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Well, hey, thanks for being here today. Before you sit down, kids are going to make their way to class. Why don't you adults in the room shake hands with somebody? Say good morning.
Well, good morning. Welcome. Thanks for being here. Are you making fun of my legs? He's making fun of my legs. It's reflective. Don't look at my legs. It's so much glare that comes off of them. Okay, so hey, we're getting in the tank today to baptize some people. We're very excited about that. We're also we got some things to talk about as far as announcements. But first, let me bring my ushers down. Ushers, you're fantastic. Come on down. We have a God who's blessed and blessed and blessed us, and we get to give back in this time. We get to bless him, and we get to bless this community and all the communities that it touches. So thank you for your faithfulness. Go ahead and pass those baskets. Wanted to let you also know that we've got baptisms, but we also have communion today. And if you are in need of gluten-free, thank you. The words were not coming. Eric's reading my mind. If you're in need of gluten-free, we have gluten-free wafers. So just know that those will be available in the back, right? So those are available. And we also have a few things we wanted to let you know about this morning. That is 242. First things first, 242 is coming back. I know you guys have been on the edge of your seats. We're back this Wednesday at 6 p.m. to have a meal together, to pray together. Mom and Dad, Grandma, Grandpa, you don't have to cook. You come here, you get a good meal, and we sit around a table, and we just have fun together. Are you in?
Yeah.
Wow. You could do better, all right? I mean, all right, here, let's try this. Can I say something else? Listen, okay, when I was a kid, there was this phrase, right? There was this phrase that a lot of people would say when you were raising kids. They would say, it takes a village. There you go. Okay, so it takes a village. Now, in my mind, that's what 242 is. It's our village, okay? It's a space that you can come. Mom, Dad, Grandma, Grandpa can come, and they can know that there's going to be other people there, like-minded people that want to share life together. that our village has now gotten so big that the village is hard to maintain. So you come here, and this can be your village. Today, we have lots of villages. 242 can be one of your villages. It can be a place to just kind of sit around a table, pray together, play together, get to know new people. If there's a baby crying in the room, someone else can get up and say, hey, I'll help you, Mom. I'll help you, Dad. We will share this journey together, right? See, we're on the same page, yes. So come to 242, have a good meal, and share life together. That would be great. All right, next thing. What is my next thing? Oh, it's worship night this week. I almost forgot to say it. We have worship night this Wednesday after our good meal together. And to go with the village theme, village people. That's what we're going to be. I'm joking. We're not doing that. That joke worked way better in the first service. My delivery. It was all the delivery. YMCA, yes. So worship night this Wednesday should be great. Last thing I wanted to let you know about is we've got our tear-off at the bottom. If there's any information that has changed for you, email address, name, city you live in, all that fun stuff, let us know. But more importantly, on the back, there is a place for we can learn how to be praying for you better. We have a community of people that are praying regularly for this church, for the people in this church, and so we want to know how to pray for you. So let us know. Let us know how we can pray for you or maybe people in your family, and you can know that you're not alone, that you've got a God who's with you, and you've got us, your family, family in Christ that's with you as well. I think that's it. We talked about communion. We talked about baptism. We've got several baptisms this morning, but I also want to let you know that you are free to step in as well, even if you weren't prepared to come into that tub today, okay? If you came and you feel moved, we would love to have a conversation with you. So feel the freedom to do that, and we can make sure that we get you towels and clothes and all that stuff. We'll make it happen. All right, let's pray. Jesus, thank you for this day. Lord, to come off the high of Easter and to still be celebrating the resurrection today, 1 week later, Lord, and that goes on and on and on and on. We're so grateful for you, Lord. We're grateful for the people that are going to step into the baptismal today and make that incredible decision. And we're also grateful that we just get to be here and celebrate you. So help us to celebrate you. Help us to lean into your word now and glean and be guided by your spirit. In your name, amen. Wafer?
No, thanks. I get extra gluten. I always, when I order, I just say, hey, all of the gluten you've taken out of people's food because they're intolerant, add it to mine. I'm a huge gluten fan. Hey, I got to have a great time visiting with my new grandbaby this weekend. Yeah, totally hilarious. Just, oh, crazy. And she was in an orphanage for about 18 months, only around women, so I couldn't play with her, I can make her laugh and giggle and those kind of things, but I didn't get a hug. Lynn gets a hugs. Yeah, I'm not already liking this. This isn't right. So pray for me if you would. So last Sunday was really cool. We came in and the projector was broken, and so that's being repaired. And this week we came in and the baptismal's leaking. There's water all over the stage, and take the cross out because that's made of metal, and it was sitting in water, and that's out back drying. So I love my job. I don't think that we replaced my juice with wine. Maybe we did. Okay, we're going to go through this message rather quickly because we have communion and baptisms, and So I want to talk to you about baptism, about communion. I want to tell you about this series. The whole point of this series has been to how do we get to know what God is like? Humanity has just guessed at that question. Humanity wonders, is there a God? And if there's a God, what's this God like? And so what we learn in the Bible is that you can know about God just looking at creation. You can know a little bit. You can know he's all powerful. You can know he's really creative and imaginative. I mean, look at just this room and how different we all are. We can know those things, but we don't know the heart of God. We don't know what he likes. We don't know what's important to him. We don't know how he thinks and how he feels. And so humanity has just guessed until Jesus. And that's what this series has been about, that Jesus steps in and he says, I am here. I am the same one that spoke to Abraham, spoke to Moses, spoke to the prophets. I am, and I'm here. When he said to Moses, I am who I am, Jesus began to use that moniker to describe himself. So that's what we've looked at in this series, and I want to come and jump into one of these today because, man, I don't know about you, but I want to know what God thinks is important. I want to know how God responds to people. I want to know what he does with people who are living their life really well, and I want to know how he responds to people who are living their life really poorly. I want to know how he feels about me and you. I want to know. And what this series has pointed out to us is that we can know what God is like by looking in the face of Jesus. So I'm going to read a very familiar passage, and we're going to just jump into this because I say this is familiar. It's familiar if you've ever been to a memorial service, because that's usually where this is read, but it's important to us now because we're going to talk about how it applies in our lives, in baptism, in communion. So John 14, beginning in verse 1, says this, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." That's the words of Jesus. "My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place I am going." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Now, that's just a great question, isn't it? Because what he has in his mind is a physical place, that there must be a physical God living in a physical place, that Jesus must be going there. We don't know how to get there. I mean, how do we get our mind around that? But as I shared last week, God is so much bigger than simply a being. He is created all beings. He's beyond that. When Moses said, "What is your name? Because I want to tell people which God sent me," he says, I'm not able to fit in your category of gods. I'm beyond all of that. There is one God, and it is me. I am who I am," is what he says. And so Jesus answered Thomas's question, "How can we know the way?" And Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." And then Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." And Jesus said, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you for such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'?" Now, this passage is an interesting one because some people just love what they think is being said here, and other people really don't love what they think is being said here. But I would argue that so much more is being declared by Jesus in this statement than any of us really get our minds around. Jesus is making a statement about himself. He says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And we need to understand what that means. And we're going to look at it through the lens of baptism. So he says that he is the way. Well, he's the way to what? He's the way to God. Jesus says, that's what I'm the way to. If you want to know God, I'm the way. I'm the way that you can see him. I'm the way that you can experience him. I'm the way you can know what God thinks and how he feels. I'm the way for you to know that. Just look at me. Pay attention to me. And in that, how Jesus brings about that is through resurrection. The way to God is in resurrection. Now, I want you to get this. If Jesus is the physical representation of who God is, and he's saying, this is who God truly is, then we need to look at the life of Jesus to be able to get our minds around what God is really like. Now, we have this picture in our minds that God is all-powerful. He's this grandpa in the sky. He has he's holy and righteous, and he just is wholly other. No way we can relate to him. But then Jesus says, yes, you can. And I'm going to show you what God's really like. And here he is, the all-powerful God of the universe. And he goes to the cross and he dies. He is whipped, beaten. He's stabbed. He's got a crown of thorns stuck into his head. Nails into his hands and into his feet. This is the one who says, I am. That is experiencing this. That the eternal God has figured out a way to die and then be raised to new life for us. This is mind-boggling. This is beyond comprehension. You're not going to ever get that by just looking around. But you see that in Jesus. And in baptism, what we do in baptism, this is a great picture. We say, okay, you're going to die and be buried and then be raised to new life. That's the picture of baptism. By the way, if you're getting baptized today, you don't actually die. But you are to die to something. You're to die to self. You're to die to sin. There's a great deal that God says, I want you to die to your old way of thinking. I want you to die to the worldly way of being, and I want you to be raised to a new life, my kind of life. Romans 6, Paul writes these words. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? You know, he's saying we're forgiven by God's grace, so maybe the more I sin, the more grace I get, and so I'm going to sin big because I love God's grace. But he says this, by no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Somehow in baptism, we share in the death of Christ. And we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. That's what is taking place in baptism. That is what God is doing in all of you who have been baptized or who will be baptized today. So the way to God, Jesus says, is through me, through my life, death, and resurrection. Then he says, I'm the truth. And the truth of what? Well, I'm the truth of God. And what is the truth of God? What does it do to us? Well, it brings cleansing. It cleanses us. It cleans us. You know, in baptism, we sprinkle water for those who want to be sprinkled, but we also immerse. We dunk. And one of the things that baptism represents is just beautiful. It is that your sins are being washed away. And so I know many of you, and I know the kind of life you've been living. So when you get baptized, some of you we need to hold down longer than others. We actually have some Brillo pads in the tub today for some of you. I mean, some of you need a good cleaning, right? Why? Because what is being pictured in this is that our sins are being washed away. Now, this cleansing is so interesting, and it is absolutely so necessary. A few weeks ago, I preached on Jesus saying that he's the true vine. I am the vine. Listen to that verse. There's a verse in the middle of it that kind of just doesn't make sense with the illustration. But listen to what it says. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. Now, this is interesting. Jesus is using the vine and the branches illustration. In the middle of it, he says, you are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. It doesn't fit the illustration. But he has to bring it up. He has to bring up this cleansing, this need for cleansing, the necessity for cleansing. Because He says, what he's saying is this, you can't be in me and in, well, the muddy mess of your life. You need me to cleanse you. I've shared this story before, but I'll just say it again. When I was about 18, 19 years old, I was babysitting my half-siblings, and my little sister was about 4 at the time, and I was babysitting like any 18, 19-year-old does. I was laying on the couch watching football, and I heard the hose go on outside, and I thought, uh-oh, the kids are playing with the hose. Something's up. So I go back, and there's my little sister, Dawn, beautiful, curly hair, blonde, just adorable little kid. Well, she was covered from head to toe in mud. She had gotten into the garden that Dad had just rototilled, and she was head to toe in mud. And I come outside. I'm like, what are you doing? Because that's what big brothers do. And I also knew I was going to be in big trouble for this one. So she had the hose on. At 4 years old, she knew that she couldn't go in the house the way she was. So she's got the garden hose, and she's trying to wash the mud off of herself so she can come inside. But all she's doing is making a bigger mess. She's just spreading it around. And so I took her and I took the hose and I washed her off the best I could. I got big beach towels and I wrapped her in them and I carried her in, took her in and put her in the shower and I cleaned her all up, threw her clothes and the towels in the wash, and I didn't get in trouble. That was good. But here's the deal. Most of us spend our whole life trying to clean ourselves up. We can't do it. We just make a bigger mess. Jesus says, I've come to wash away your sin. I've come to take it all and to clothe you in righteousness. The Bible says, though your sins were as scarlet, now they're white as snow. Just an amazing picture. What happens in baptism is what God's promising to do for you for the rest of your life, to wash away your sin. So he's the way to God, he's the truth of God, and then he also says this, I'm the life, I'm life with God. And life with God in the Bible has a very specific word. That word is covenant. And covenant is a great concept that God has. Let me give you a definition of what covenant is, because people can have a covenant with each other. They can make promises to each other. But a divine covenant is when God initiates and he binds together into a living relationship, a relationship that brings blessing and obligation. Okay, so God initiated binding living relationship with blessing and obligation. There's five covenants listed in the Old Testament. First one was with Noah. And God says, I'm going to promise you to preserve your life through the judgment. And I'm not just doing this for you. I'm going to do it for your family because I am not just preserving your family, but all the families of the world in the future. I'm making this covenant with you, but it's not just about you, Noah. It's about all that will come. And your obligation to me is to do what you've been doing, live a righteous life, walk faithfully with me. And that was a covenant with Noah. Then he makes a covenant with Abraham. And he says, I'm going to bless you, Abraham. I'm going to make your name great. I'm going to give you an offspring. And through your seed, all the nations of the world will be blessed. Again, not just for Abraham, but for all the nations of the world. The seed is not just his son Isaac, who will come, but the seed he's pointing to is actually Jesus. And what he has to do is live into that. He makes a covenant with Moses, and he says, I'm going to promise, I'm going to deliver my people from slavery through you, Moses, and I'm going to lead them to the promised land. And your job then is to live in this way that you reflect my character by obedience to me. That's why God gave Moses the law, the commandments. Then he made a covenant with David, and David's is interesting because David said, I'm going to do something great for God. God says, give it up. Just give it up. He says, David goes, I'm going to build you a house. I'm going to build you a temple. God says, no, you're not. But I'm going to build a house for you. I'm going to build a heritage. I'm going to build a dynasty for you. That David, there will be one that will come in your family like you, and like the son of David. And that's pointing to Jesus. And he just needed to continue to walk with God and be a friend of God. That was his obligation. But God says, I'm going to do something huge through you, David. And then the new covenant is what's listed. And the new covenant is listed in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And it's a fascinating promise that God makes. He says, all of the promises I've made are now going to be fulfilled at one time, in one place, by one person. They're all going to be fulfilled by Jesus. Jesus steps in. He fulfills all of the promises of God. And all of the promises are based on this, not law. They're all based on relationship. You're invited into this divine human relationship. That's what a covenant is. And not only this, but what we learn is that this covenant that is gets fulfilled in Jesus actually began before the creation of time. God was already promising to do all of this work for us before the beginning of time. So this is what's fascinating. When we baptize somebody, we baptize them and we say, now you are a child of the covenant. Now you're in a relationship with God and with the people of God who are also in covenantal relationship. And here's what's great. You're being welcomed into the family. When you're baptized, you're being welcomed into God's family with God's people, which makes us all sisters and brothers, which is absolutely, well, if anything will change you, it's having to live with your sisters and brothers. It's where we get irritated. It's where we find joy. It's where we have conflict. It's where we find reconciliation. It's where there's hope and there's discouragement, where there's great success and things to celebrate, and there's reasons for real heartache and loss in the family of God. But listen to what he says, what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians. He says, you have to understand that this being welcomed into the family is not what you've done. It's what God has done. He says, such confidence we have through Christ before God. Not that we are competent in ourselves to claim anything for ourselves, but our competence comes from God. He has made us competent, look at this, as ministers of a new covenant. Not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. See, you get invited into the family, not legally, but spiritually. And it brings life. And he says that we are ministers of this new covenant. What does that mean? It means, well, when we baptize someone, we ask them three questions. We ask the question, is Jesus your Lord and Savior? Are you aware of who he is, that he's the one that's calling the shots in your life? He's the Lord. He's the boss. And he's the one bringing forgiveness. He's your Savior. And everyone being baptized needs to say yes to that. Then secondly, the second question we ask is, okay, are you working at letting go of sin and relying on the grace of God to help you do that? That's the cleansing question. And hopefully they say, yeah, I'm working on that too. And then thirdly, we say, now are you part of God's family from here on out, the church? And that's not just membership into a church. That's membership into the church, big C, wherever you go, wherever you live, you're part of a Christian church. That's the questions we ask. But then we ask the congregation, for the people being baptized, do you promise to give your support, love, encouragement, to welcome them, to pray for them, to provide for them? Will you be a part of their journey with God? Why do we ask you that question? Well, because you're part of the family. They're being welcomed into the family. So that's the question we ask you. By the way, will you make that promise to everybody being baptized today? Will you? Yes. Yeah, that's kind of pathetic. You need to be a little more emphatic. Will you make the promise to love them and to care for them and pray for them and encourage them, provide Sunday school for them and to worship with them and celebrate what God's doing in their life? Will you do that?
Yes.
Oh, that's way better. That all takes place in baptism. But you know where it also takes place? In communion. In communion. Listen to what Jesus says. He says, he took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. And he gave it to them saying this, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And the same way, after supper, he took the cup saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." It's the new covenant. Here's where it all comes together. Every time you and I take communion, we go through this whole process. We say, "God, I want resurrection. I know this is the way to God. I want to die to self and be raised to new life. God, I want your cleansing. Please forgive me." And I hope when you take communion that you're asking God for forgiveness, because I know that all of you came in this morning a little muddy from the week. Anybody? Amen. Yeah. Some, just a little bit on your shoes. Thank you for that. Others of you, you're like my little sister. Head to toe, God can bring cleansing to you again today. And then thirdly, you're being reminded that you're not just someone who has faith in Jesus, but that you're part of the family of God. And as such, that brings responsibility into your life. It brings blessing into your life. When you receive communion, the same things that are being stated in baptism is being stated at communion. This, you only have to do one time in your life. But this, we do over and over because we need it over and over and over. So, we're going to share this communion now. And we're going to also begin baptisms. Now, some of you have let us know that you are prepared to be baptized this morning, and that's wonderful. And in just a couple minutes, I'll have you come up. But others of you maybe weren't thinking about that, but maybe now are considering that possibility. I'm going to be over here, and if you are interested, talk with me. And today might be the day that you get to experience the way, the truth, and the life. So communion service, come on up. As we heard, Jesus said on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, he blessed it, he broke it. He said, "It's my body. It's broken for you. Take and eat." And he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant poured out in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sin. Take and drink. And every time you do so, do it in remembrance of me." We're reminded that when we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. And so let's receive this communion today. Jesus, thank you that we who are baptized already get a chance to remember our baptism and celebrate baptisms with others. And God, for those of us who are not yet baptized, I pray, God, that you would speak to our hearts and our minds, and that the promises that are necessary come first and foremost from you. It's your promise to bring new life to us. It's your promise to raise us from the dead. It's your promise to cleanse us from our sin. It's your promise to welcome us into the family. God, may we celebrate that this day. In Jesus' name. Amen. So if you are being baptized or are considering that, you're welcome to come on up. We'll serve you communion while you're coming up in line, and the rest of us will receive that in our chairs.
Been traveling these wide roads so long, my heart's been far from you, 10,000 miles gone. Oh, I want to come near and give you every part of me, but there's blood on my head, my lips are unclean. In my darkness I remember Mama's words reoccur to me. Surrender to the good Lord, and he'll wipe your slate clean. Take me to your river. I want to go Take me to your river. I wanna go. Dip me in your smooth water. I'm going. There's a man with many cries come up for air. As my sins flow down the Jordan, oh, I wanna come near and give you every part of me. But there's blood on my hands, my lips are unclean. Take me to your river, I wanna go. Take me to your river, I wanna go. I wanna go, wanna go, 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 wanna go. Oh, I wanna go, wanna go, wanna go, wanna go. I wanna go, wanna go, wanna go. Oh, let me know. Take me to your river. I wanna go.
Take and eat.
Take me to your river. I wanna go. Oh, oh, oh. Take me to your river. I wanna go.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Whom the sun sets free, oh, is free. He has ransomed me, oh, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me, whom the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed.
We're creation, suddenly articulate, with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we did Christ be magnified. With the whole earth echoing His eminence, His name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountaintops. We dear Christ be magnified. Sing it all, Christ be magnified. Let His praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Sing it all, Christ be magnified. The altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Every creature finds its inmost melody. And every human heart its native cry. Then in one, in raptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. Singing, oh, Christ be magnified. Just let His praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Singing, oh, Christ be magnified. The altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. If it puts me through the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. And I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. Because if the cross brings transformation, you can't hang me there with you. Oh, because death is just a doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you in your eyes. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be saved. My song will be the same. Singing, oh, Christ be magnified. Just let his praise arise. Christ be magnified. Hear me. Singing, oh, Christ be magnified. From the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Singing, oh, Christ be magnified. Just let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Singing, oh, Christ be magnified. The altar of my life. Christ be magnified. In me. Magnify. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the blood that makes me white as snow. Found I know nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other found I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, nothing but the blood of Jesus. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My melody. I'll raise a hallelujah when heaven comes to fight for me. And I'm going to sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're going to hear my praises roar. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. hallelujah. With everything inside of me, I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah. In the middle of the mystery, I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you lost your hold on me. I'm gonna sing now. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. Sing a little louder.
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 Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah. Is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God, how great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, you are worthy of all praise, and my heart is our God. Name above all names, you are worthy of great is our God.
Come on, one more time. We're going to sing that chorus. Will you stand with us as we close?
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. How great is our God.
I thought you'd have the mic on to sing it with us.
No, I turned the mic off when I sang. Oh. Yeah. As a gift to the congregation, that's what I do. Hey, I invite all of you to hug somebody who is soaking wet. Just welcome them into the family. Let them know that they're part of us. And we're part of God's family, the covenant family. It's such a blessing to share in these and to share communion together. I pray that that you will walk in the awareness of what God's done here today, changing lives for eternity. Amen. Hey, God bless you. Have a great week. Get some coffee and donuts.